At the start of this 21-day fast, this Isaiah 58 fast that he's chosen, he says he's chosen that fast. We've opened the door of some personal responsibility toward our faith walk with Jesus. Some of you know last week we talked about the cross. We talked about the sacrifice. We stressed the need to follow Paul's words in Philippians 2:17. And it says that we must work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. How many of you hear that? If you were left to yourself, how good would you be in God? If you were left to yourself, how strong would you be in God? Think about a baby. If you give birth to a baby and just set them in a room, that baby's not going to last very long. Come on. And how many of you know that we've come to a place where we've become our own worst enemy as far as it is to growing and maturing in Christ? And I've often talked about my early days and coming up in Christ. I came to a great church, a dynamite church, awesome church. I've only been to two churches in my life, and that one and then here that I belong to, the one in Virginia Beach and the one here. It's only two churches I've ever joined or been a part of. And in that process, I came out of a church that was strong in the demonstration and the power of God and strong in the teaching of revelation and the word, so that we had structure and we had power. Can you hear me? And we need to always look at that and make sure that we're watching how we keep that balance going on. Now, we ended last week with the cry of Jesus that we must take up our cross and follow him. How many of you know we have to take up our cross? And that's important to understand. His cross is our walk. His cross is our walk. Now, we are not asked to die for him, but to live like and for him every day. Can you hear that? And yes, we must die, but we're only dying to self, and who's our greatest battle field that we have to deal with is the battle of self. And so we're not giving up our lives, we're giving up our selfish life. Can you hear that? But in humility and in brokenness, I wrote this down last week, in humility and brokenness, we will make room for God to release his strength through our weaknesses in order to accomplish his plan. So humility and brokenness is going to cause us to make room for God to release his strength through our weakness and to be able to accomplish his plans. Now, before I go there, and I'm about to, but I want to say this, his plans. What are his plans? His plans. What on earth are his plans? How many of you know the Lord has plans? As a father and a mother would for a child, they have plans for that child, right? And so God the Father, he has plans. He had plans for Adam and Eve. He has plans. Even Jeremiah said, chapter 29, Jeremiah said, I know the plans the Lord has for me and for you. Can you hear that? The Lord has plans for us. And so God the Father, he brings us into a revelation and a place where the cross is real and we accept Jesus. But here's the thing, if we don't walk with him and take up our cross, we gather up a false religion. There's a lot of Christians today that are going to be so disappointed when they die because they're not making it. And I can prove all that because Scripture, Matthew and its other places tells us, the disciples and people came and said, you know, we did this and we did that and we did this in your name. Jesus says, depart from me. I don't even know you. You can put all the religious drapings on. You can put all the robes on. You can put all the gear on that you want. And it's not going to usher you into the things of God. Hello? And I was watching the video yesterday, my wife and I, and these were 7 or 8 key leaders of the body of Christ. And I was supposed to be on that committee, but on that panel on that particular subject. And it's a new thing called Zoom. It's a video conferencing. It's video. So everybody's in the little cubes and everybody's talking. You can hear, see, move everything. And it's pretty fascinating how you can do that now. And it'll save a lot of money. We want it to fly to different things. We can go to conferences without doing that. And in that process, I was listening to some of the things these guys were talking about. And these are my peers. These are guys that I've grown up with. And I was listening to them, and I was hearing the same thing repeated over and over. And they were talking about where the church is and what God wants to do with his church. And you and I are the subject of God's discussion in the glorious eternities of heaven. Are you listening? We are on the lips of God every single day. The Bible says that Jesus is before the throne of God making intercession on behalf of the saints every day. So God is ministering, Jesus is ministering to the Father about you every single day. How many of you know the heart of God has to be overwhelmed that when his own son who bought and paid for us is now giving a daily report about his children, don't you know it makes the heart of God proud? Think about this. The angels are worshiping God every day. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Jesus is at the right hand of the Father, and he's daily talking about interceding for you. And the Father gets to hear him as he prays over you, and as he prays over me, and he prays over our lives. God the Father is listening, and heaven is listening. Angels are listening, and Jesus is declaring, he will be, and she will be, and they'll answer the call, and they'll run after me, and they'll do this and that. And God himself is filled with the sound of your voice. Can you get that? The Bible says when we sing that he comes and sings in our midst. The Bible says he rejoices over us with singing. The word rejoice there means jumps in the air and spins around. I'm trying to give you a picture of what heaven could look like at 11 o'clock on a Sunday day. Hello? What does heaven look like at 11:30 on Sunday? Well, this is a picture that you have the throne, an emerald green rainbow, a covenant rainbow. You have this anointed cherubs standing there saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord. You have the Son of God with marks in his hands, and he's there before at the right hand of the Father, and he's interceding, and you have the Holy Spirit and Jesus communicating constantly while they're talking to the Father. Wow, what a picture. And angels are going and coming, and heaven is full of an army. There's an army in heaven, and the army is there, and they're poised on the edge of eternity, ready to come in and intercede on our behalf. And all of heaven is lit up with this sound of praise and sounds of worship and magnification of who God is. And when the Holy Spirit sends the word up and says, boy, they're worshiping me at Rock City Church. They're worshiping you, Father, at Rock City Church. Father God is filled at that moment. That's my children. That's my kids. They're just celebrating me. They're worshiping me. My son travels a lot, my oldest son. He'll go on a tour coming up. He was in Philadelphia this weekend. He's a musician. And he travels all over. He'll go to Europe and be in Europe for 6-7 weeks and go all over Europe. And he owns a couple of restaurants in town, and he's become very successful. The restaurant has done extremely well. And because of it, they go to Mexico for their supplies, and they do things, and they travel. His wife goes there and back. And so they're constantly in a travel mode. And whenever my son goes away, he always tells me, or my wife and I, and he sends me a note. He says, I'll be away, Dad. And he's telling me he's going away. Well, I know what he's telling me. He wants me to pray for him. I know he came by the church the other day, and he stepped in just before he went to Philadelphia. He was actually on his way there. And so I know how he works. But there's no greater joy than to have my son come tell me all the good report about what God has done for him and how the restaurant is blessed and how his music, he just gave us a rundown of the music and downloaded it to my wife, and they just did a new album, and man, he was talking about it, and oh, it was good. How many know, as a dad, you just relish, you just bathe in that report. Are you listening to me today? And so get the picture here today that heaven, and that's why I prod you, that you have an open ear. When we open the heavens by our worship and praise, we enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. When we do that, you have an opportunity to have your voice heard on high by God himself. And for us to come in and just like, heaven every day is discussing your future. How many of you know the calendar of God has your day that it ends? And God, being God, can look at his calendar and he knows that on this day, thy soul is required of thee. Nothing goes on, saints, in the universe of everything that we know. Nothing goes on that God himself, being sovereign, isn't aware of. If the sparrow doesn't fall to the ground, then how in the world do we think that this creation that is in his image and likeness could do anything that God the Father doesn't already know that you're about to do it? He sees the beginning from the end. He knows what you're going to do, when you're going to do it. He knows when you disobey, and he knows when you obey. You don't understand the sovereignty of God, then you'll think you and God are somehow living on two different planes of planet Earth. But there's never a day. The Bible says you're going to give account of every idle word you've ever spoken. He knows every word on the tip of your tongue. He knows every hair in your head. If you're bald, he knows the fuzz. He knows every single thing about you. He knows your beginning. He knows your end. He knows when you rise and he knows when you fall. He knows everything about you because he's sovereign. I'm trying to bring God's viewpoint in here for us to realize that we just can't just casually drift along and think somehow in the last moment we can reach out our hand and grab God as a rescue hook. You here today? I came to preach. I didn't come to babysit you. I didn't come here to sing you a lullaby. I came here to stir you up and activate something and activate your faith that you could believe God for the miracles that you want to see happen in your life. Wow. Remember now, humility and brokenness always makes room for God to release his strength, not yours, but his. In your weakness and in every area, for him to accomplish his purpose. Now, well, let's talk about these plans. In America, he has plans. And we are in his plans. You can say, am I in his plans? Sure, you're in his plans. One thing I know, there is and will be a people who embody his plans on the earth. Now, the how and the who, I'm going to tell you about. I'm going to tell you about the why on Thursday nights. Now, I'm talking to those of you that really are after God. I'm focused on something here, saints. God may take his church down to 10. You watch this summer. There are going to be anarchy and riots in the streets of America like we have never seen. There are already things being done militarily to prepare for what's coming. Bloodshed will increase in the streets of America this summer. And I can tell you that the church today is not ready for leadership, rulership, dominion, any of those things that we have preached at nausea for the last 20 years. The church is asleep in Zion and is not mature enough to handle any of those things. But God always has a remnant. He always has a remnant. The gawkers, the sightseers, they'll never survive. It's quiet in here today. Now, before we look at the how and the who, I encourage you to find time on Thursday evening to come together and hear the why. It's in clear form. If you come, you'll hear why God has a plan. Generational breakdowns. How many of you know God is a generational God? Just for a second, we've been discussing the upcoming 500th year birthday of one of the greatest events known to man. It's the greatest Reformation of history. It happened on October 31st, 1517. And a great Reformation took place. What do I care about a Reformation? You better care. How many of you are glad that you have a Bible today? If you didn't hear that the Reformation was in Wittenberg, Germany, and because of that, the Wittenberg Press was released to begin to print Bibles, and the Bible became out and available where it had not been available before. So the last Reformation changed out of the book of Galatians and Romans. A young man named Martin Luther had an encounter with God. He was riding his horse and lightning hit the ground and knocked him off his horse and stunned him, knocked him out. When he came to, he had a revelation of who God was. Preachers thought that was Paul, and they preached it incorrectly. They said it was in the book of Acts. It's not in the book of Acts. Paul was never on a horse. He never got knocked off a horse. There's no scripture at all that Paul rode a horse. Hello? He was short enough that he could have only rode a donkey. But I want to stop for a minute and make sure that you hear this. Do you have those chart that I put up Thursday night, Angela? Yeah. There it is. Thank you, sweetie. Look at that. The generations here that I mentioned earlier, I'm just going to take a second to remind you. This is how the Jewish tradition was set up, and this is how Jews see generations. Conception to 12 years old, 12 years old to 25, 25 to 50, and 50 to 70. And these generations, there's four generations living on the earth. Now, I'm going to help you by saying this. Each one of these, and I'll go backwards. How many of you know my generation is the one that is the baby boomer, and we're in the 60, 70 year range? How many of you hear that? We're the ones that God messed up, and we got all involved in the Jesus movement and the hippie movement. How do you know? We were the hippies. And what we did was we rebelled against God, and some, by the great Jesus movement, were swept into the kingdom of God and became preachers. I'm a product. Many of my friends and peers are a product of that. And then if that's generation number four, if you count that way, going down generation number three, is another generation that we saw what they did, and then you go to two, you go to one. Now, my generation took prayer out of school. My generation in the 60s took prayer out of school. But the third generation behind us, because it always gets worse, it took God out of everything. It took God out of school, out of movies, out of everything. God was extracted out of everything. You see, even with us, the hippies, when we pulled prayer out, there was still a God consciousness, and we knew that God still existed. Hello? When I grew up, and I was born in 1949, when I grew up in all those, some of you think, 49? Good God. That's a long time ago. I'll be 68 in about a month or less. And in that process, I grew up in a time in the 50s and 60s, and when they pulled prayer out of school, we saw the decline of a godness about God in a whole generation. My generation was left without any strict constitutional structure about God. But then we raised up children, and those children went out, and those children, out of the ones that were rebellious, those went out and took God out of everything. They're the ones running the nation. And then the next generation, which is the that 12 to 25 group, that's number two. The second 12 to 25, they're a generation now that plays video games, kills each other in the streets, and don't know who they are, has lost their identity, their LBGQY72W, whatever it is. They have lost themselves in an acronym. They don't know who they are. Can you imagine a time my dad would have flipped out when a boy don't know he's a boy and a girl don't know she's a girl? My dad would have just, he was an old Carolina boy, and he would have been in trouble. How many of you hear that? But what happened is we took prayer out. The next generation, our kids are rebellion. They took God out. The next generation, 12 to 25s, they now live without God, and they've become worse because the God they chose was called self. And so they're the self God. That means they trust in themselves. They rely on themselves. They believe in themselves, and self is their whole everything. Now, the next ones down are the product of the destruction, because if you take God out, you take prayer out, you take God out, you leave an immoral culture that wants to kill each other and has no concern about, look at spring break right now, kids down there ODing on alcohol and drugs and all that goes on, and all that's going on, and the riots, that the anarchy that will hit our streets again this summer, and all that's going on, the next generation, those conception to 12, they haven't got a prayer. Who's going to guide them? You listen to what I tell you, and I say this prophetically, they won't even want to go to church. They won't even be, you won't be able to drag them there. Some of you that drag your kids today, they won't even be able to be dragged there. They won't want God. They won't even care or know there is a God. So in four generations, we're able to take God out of a culture and leaves us to where we are today in the message. Anybody still here? Now that's Thursday night. If you want to get educated, you need to come to church. Now look at this. This young man, October 31st, 1517, named Martin Luther, a German monk. His father wanted him to be a lawyer, but instead he was a monk. Who had just prior to the Great Revolution, that some called it, what happened with him, he had had an encounter with God. That's when riding a horse, lightning struck near him and knocked him off to the ground. Boom, he came to. When he did, he had an epiphany that God was who he said he was. And it was shortly after that that he shook the world. This one young man shook the known world. He didn't just shake a neighborhood. He didn't shake a city. He shook the world. Hey, listen to this. And the anniversary of that is October 31st, 500 years. Now what he did, he took this that shook the world, he took his theses, he wrote down 95 different points. They were paragraphs like, of his opinion, of his revelation that he had with God. And it came out of the book of Romans. Put it on the board, please. Romans chapter 1, verse 17. It got out of Romans 1, 17. Now, he took Galatians and he rewrote Galatians, and he got revelation from Galatians and Romans both. And that spawned his 95 theses, which he went to the Castle Church in Wittenberg, and he nailed it to the door of the Catholic priest, the priest there, and he said to them that this is what he was declaring. Well, that stirred everything. They put him in prison. They called him a crazy man. They called him a lunatic. They said that he was just out of his mind to believe such a thing. But I want to tell you something. God prevailed on his behalf. If you don't know these stories in history, saints, you don't know the root of your Christianity. You don't know where you came from. Have you here? You see, I know my root of my Christianity because I study, because I've learned, I've read. I know the root of how it came through periods and how it came through times. And here's this young man, and he puts this on the Wittenberg, Germany church, castle church there. Now, think about this. Germany has 82 million people in it, and only 1.6 million can be claimed to be born again Christians. 82 million Christians, people live in Germany, and only 1.6 million are professing born again Christians. Now, what happened in 500 years is alarming, and we've been through, of course, Hitler, and we've been through, you know, Nazism and all of those things. And all this time, come on, what in the world happened? Here it is, this young man stirs up. People got Bibles. People no longer believed that they had to have just one person, the priest, only having a Bible, but they could have a Bible so they could read and work out their own salvation. For it is in the gospel a righteousness, for in the gospel a righteousness which God ascribes is revealed, both springing from faith and leading to faith, disclosed through the way of faith that arouses to more faith. As it is written, the man who through faith is just and upright shall live, and shall live by, come on, faith. Can you hear that? So here's the key. The just, in your Bibles, would have said it this way. The just shall live by faith. What he was saying was so simple. He was saying that it was not based on works. It was based on the finished work of Jesus. That took religion and flipped it upside down on its head. Because now all of a sudden this thing changed. It was no longer me having to try to earn my way to God. It was something Jesus paid for. He bought my salvation, and I could be an heir of God without having to do that on myself. But I needed to participate with what he paid for. You hear me? Man, what a story. Now, here's a quote from this young man. At last, meditating day and night by the mercy of God, I began to understand that the righteousness of God is that through which the righteous live by a gift of God, namely by faith. Here I felt as if I were intimately born again and had entered paradise itself through the gates that had been flung open. Now, what he had done was come to the revelation, the just shall live by faith. It turned his world upside down. How many of you would like to have an encounter with God that turned your world upside down? You see, most of us today want enough God that we can just be happy when we need to be, but don't interrupt my plan, my schedule. I'm doing this and I have this agenda and this agenda. Don't disrupt it. My cry after all my years of 40-some years now, 44 years, do you know what the cry, and I heard it by all these top Christian leaders just yesterday, you know what the cry of the leadership of the church is? That God would raise up some young men and young women that would take their cross and decide to leave things on the side, that side of the Jordan, and go over with God. And decide to live for God in missions and in ministry and totally. Because saints, we need a reformation before we're going to have a revival. We must have a reformation, that's the title, before we have a revival. So if you catch me today and catch what I'm saying, we need the reforming of our mind. You see, what Luther did was he changed the way he was thinking. He knew God, but he was changed so drastically, he changed the way he thought. He had a kingdom perspective of God. He had a kingdom perspective of the world. How many of you know, most of you sitting here have no sense at all about a Christian worldview? What is it? Christianity was for me to help me get out of my oops and boops and all my problems. Jesus said it this way in John, I came to save that which was lost, not those. Jesus came to save that which was lost, not those. The that which God gave Adam and Eve in the beginning, he gave them the plan of dominion and rule and to reign and take authority over the whole earth. But God wants to give it back to the church. But here we are today after 500 years and we're having to be begged to pray. Hello. And if we're going to see a revival that'll sweep through this nation and up the East Coast like prophets have prophesied, we're going to have a reformation. That reformation is going to mean you and I are going to change the way we treat Jesus. And we're going to go back to what I said a minute ago. Can you imagine what it looked like this morning when we were in here and some of us were worshiping God? All of a sudden, heaven was picking that signal up from all over the nation and around the world. And Jesus is there before the Father, and he's listening to the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost is sending the signal, and Jesus is interceding to the Father. That's the good church. That's the one God to glorify. That's the one that's sold out to you. That's the missionary. And that intercession is going on all day, 24/7. How many of you know the throne of God is not boring? There's activity in the throne of God, saints. Heaven's decisions are being made every day. God is choosing by the Holy Spirit, Jesus and the Holy Spirit communicating, and the Holy Spirit is instructing us as his ambassador, as his agent of change. You don't have the Holy Ghost today? I don't know how you think you're hearing Jesus, because Jesus is at the right hand of the Father, and the Holy Spirit is here in us. And he comes to live in us. He came to be we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Hello? And we're not the temple of a feeling. We're not the temple of an emotion. We're the temple of the triune third being of God who's come down from glory in a rushing mighty wind with fire. And he came and lives inside. And greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. For the hope of the world is Christ in you. Listen to this. This is by that young man, and I'll get off him. By Luther, Martin Luther, the young man. He wrote a song. He wrote a bunch of them. One of them you probably know. You sang it in your old dried up hymnal. A mighty fortress is our God. Listen to what he said. A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. That means a fortress. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing were not the right man on our side. The man of God's own choosing, don't ask who that may be, Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth, his name, that's the Lord of hosts of the armies of God, from age to age, the same, and he must win the battle that would above all earthly powers, no thanks to them abideth. The spirit and the gifts are ours, through him who with us subsideth. Let goods and kindred go. Let your possessions, family, everything go. This mortal life also, The body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever and forever. What a mighty fortress is our God. Wow. How many of you sung that when you were a kid or sung that? Look at that, it's all over. You sang the pen writing of a young man that had an encounter with God. Listen to me, saints. If you sing the songs of Beyonce, you're singing the song of her experience. Hello? If you sing the songs of those people, you're singing the songs of their experience in the world. And what you sang at a mighty fortress, you sang the experience of a young man that turned the world upside down and had an encounter with God. Wow. What a mighty God. What a mighty God. Here's another reformer. Here's a quote. Every generation of Christians, and this is the word to you today, so listen good. Every generation of Christians needs to examine its belief and practices under the microscope of Scripture to identify and purge away those worldly assertions that easily beset us and to protect jealously the freedom dearly acquired for us, both men and women, on the hill of Calvary. How do you know we need to reevaluate under the microscope of the Scripture, where are we? What is my life? Is my life any semblance to this? Or am I just dead? Am I just playing church? Or is this working in my life? Wow. Come on. I'm excited what's in front of me because I know some of the brethren around the country. God is assembling some people. And I can tell you there's apostolic centers being set up all over America. And what God's going to do is he's going to raise a remnant up. And those that have just decided they're going to go the whole journey playing church, sleep through half the service, just play the game, get angry when somebody says something that offends us, run away, hide, and play church. Or we're going to decide to be reformed and get a mindset change that means I'm going to radically live for God and change my life and donate my life to God. Can you hear me today? I'm going to try to close it. There's a generation, a remnant of people that long for demonstration, not imagination. They want the real thing. Look at these commercials like Coke commercial. Look at the Coke commercial called the, what do they call the Coke? The real thing. Look at their sports. Andy, you got that or not? Put it on there. Dim the lights and hit it. This is what they believe their sports are. That's a snowmobile, airborne. Look at that. Turn completely around. Oh my God. Kids are nuts. Yeah. What happened to riding motorcycles? Now they don't use parachutes. Miles an hour, no parachute. And you think boring Christianity, half-baked, half-committed, half-sold out, will affect them? Come on, saints. Ask yourself today, how do we present the gospel of fire and miracles to a generation that's gone off cliffs without a parachute? Hello? And yet what we're willing to do is come in and just nuzzle in and get warm and comfortable and see if we can just sit in church. Try to give away another home this year. The house has been given to us if we want to use it. 15 years, this will be the 15th house. And we're struggling because we can't get a leadership team that'll assemble to make it happen. Because we're busy. Hello. We find ourselves constantly, 140, 50 kids will come in here and get touched and get a reality of Christianity. Let's close. How many of you are sitting here today listening to me? How can the gospel that you carry match that? Yet that is the world that's out there. They don't do games like football, baseball, basketball. They make up their own game. Take a motorcycle and see how close to the back blade of a helicopter you can trim the rubber off the bike's wheel. And we're going to say, come to church. All together, kumbaya, my friend. Now look at this. Look at these things. It's no wonder we're losing an entire generation to animated heroes on TV and con men on the street corners. I'm going to give you three scriptures you have got to see, and that's where I'm landing. Lamentations 4:1. Put it on the board, please. Lamentations 4:1. The sacred gems are scattered at every street corner. How the gold has become dim. How the most pure gold has changed. The hallowed stones of the temple are poured out at the head of every street. How many of you understand? The noble and precious sons of Zion, once worth their weight in fine gold, how they are esteemed merely as earthen pots or pitchers, the work of the hands of the potter. It's talking about God's kids, God's people. They were treated as though they were gold at one time and precious, and they've just now become like a pot. Look at Nahum, chapter 3, verse 10. Nahum, chapter 3. Yet she was taken captive and went into exile. Her infants were dashed to pieces at every street corner. Even her little children were smashed to death at every corner. Look at this. Even the jackals draw out of the beast. What did you go? This is first supposed to be verse 10. Nahum 3, 10. Did you lose it? All right. Lamentations, do you have that? 2:19? No, forget it. Just Lamentations 2:19, if you could find that one. It says, arise, cry out in the night as the watches of the presence of the Lord. Arise from your bed, cry out in the night at the beginning of the watches. This is prayer and intercession, saints. Pour out your heart like water before the face of the Lord. Lift up your hands towards him. For the lives of your young children who faint from hunger in the head of every street. The children are in every street, saints. The children, who do you think's being killed in Chicago? Do you think those are non-Christian kids? No, they're not. Our own young man that died here just a week ago came right out of this house, shot and killed. What a tragedy. Our own kids, how many of you think in Baltimore, those kids that are killed on a weekly basis, they're coming out of the house of God. They're parents that love Jesus. Hello? While what? While we decide, let's just go to church when we want to. Go to prayer. Pastor's begging us to go to prayer. Let's at least go once. Come on, saints. You see, fasting, prayer, fasting, giving, fasting is supposed to open us up. Isn't that true? Fasting is opening us up so that God could speak to us. I don't know about you, but I know those kids, those waves and stuff. I was in that world. I know that. And I can tell you right now, we can sit in here and shout to the walls peel. But if we don't have something in our hands that's powerful, if we don't have a consistent life in our own tongue, those kids ain't even gonna give you the time of day. Because to them, they've heard everybody say that God is dead. So they had to make a movie. My friend wrote the book. God's not dead. He's still alive. Why do we have to have movies that says God's not dead? Because somebody said he is. Hello? You think there was a movie in the 60s or 70s that ever came out and said, God's not dead? No, it's come out now. Why? Because this generation has had prayer pulled out, then they had God pulled out, and this generation of 25s and up, 12 to 25s, that group right there is going, there is no God. Show me. And I hate to say it this way, but some of them are living in your home. And they're waiting for you to decide how real this really is. We've taken the manger and built a cathedral. As we build higher and higher, an entire generation sinks lower and lower in the mire of religion and apathy, never knowing who they are and why they were born. Why am I here? Why am I here? Romans 12, 16, before millions more perish, we must humble ourselves and invest in the right things, God's kingdom. Put it on the board. You can see it. We must decide and give them the reality of Jesus Christ in all its blood, guts, and scourging and mocking death at resurrection. We need to present the gospel as real as it is. See, they'll identify with hell because they've flirted with it and been there. They'll identify with hell because they've been around it. Some of these kids, one of them I was watching, studying him for last year or so. He went off the cliff on a BMW bike. He went off the cliff, but he didn't know it was the wrong cliff when he went off. He really went off at something about 800 feet. Of course, he just splattered. He never, knew what happened. These kids are living on the edge, and our gospel is in mothballs. The generation longs for a sound, a sign, a landmark to show them the way in the gross darkness. This generation is waiting for the sound of their call and destiny, and hell better be aware when they do realize it. Galatians 2:20, the last await the man, the woman, the child who will say, I am crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but it is he that lives in me. Say it again with me. Would you say it out loud? I am crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but he that lives in me. 1 Corinthians 9, 16, 17. Paul was trusted, it said, with the gospel. And woe to him, he said, if he didn't preach it. He said, the Lord trusted me with the gospel. Saints, if I bring you to a place where you surrender your life to Christ, and I bring you a gift, And those watching, I'm sorry, the lights are dark on that side. I thought they were going to be fixed. You can't see it on the video. I'm sorry. I bring you a gift. I bring you a gift of $1 million or gold worth $1 million. What'd you do with it? What did you do with it? God comes and changes your life and takes hell out of it and brings hope inside of you and joy. What did you do with what he gave you? Where did you spend it? Who is feeling a difference because of what Jesus did for you? We come to church, we drag our old bodies around. We sit in church and wait for the next bell to ring so we can go eat or have fun. And life is just the process. And the whole time, can I get a bunch of 12-year-olds to 25s to come here for a minute? And then I'll close. If you're 12 to 25 and you're in here, would you come down? If you don't mind. I'm just going to use you in an illustration. Just come down and you can face that way if you want. Don't need a long parade. If you're going to sit there and be begged to come, just sit. I don't care. Okay. Find a place. Just get somewhere. Find a place. Okay. Now, this is the next church. Okay. Hey, Antonio. Come here a minute. Will you turn my mic off, please? All right, cut me back on.
Now, this is the church. Isn't it a good-looking church? This is the church. This is the church that's going to lead us. I'm going to be right here, old, and all my beard will be gray, not just a little bit. I'm going to sit right here with my wonderful wife, and we're going to watch y'all and say, okay, where are we going now? What are we going to do next? What's God up to? Who's going to prophesy? Who's going to raise the dead? Who's going to bring in somebody that comes in like them radical crazies? And you're going to be the one loving on them, grabbing hold of them, saying, come on, come on, come on. Oh, yeah, come on. And they're going to be just all of a sudden, you know, you're going to be that one that stands up and says, I got a word from God. God said he's going to do this, and God said he's going to do that, and God said he's going to do this. And yet, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to kind of live a lazy life, and I'm just going to sit back, and I'm just going to watch you. And I'm just going to sit down and say, wow, what a great church you are. You're a good-looking bunch. Boy, you are just really something else. Y'all are just fabulous. Y'all are something else. You look so nice, all your colorful outfits. You look so nice. While I'm sitting here, the enemy has successfully, stop right there. The enemy has successfully, before I could finish preaching, took half the church right out of our midst. And we didn't do anything but wonder where we were going to eat. And my career, the hell with your career. If your generation that God has given us responsibility for can be snatched out of the church in less than 5 minutes while I'm preaching, then something's wrong in the church. Right while I was preaching, what happened to my church? They're gone. Now some of them are gone eternally. Some of them were killed in the street. Some of them are doing drugs. Some of them are pregnant and shouldn't be. Some of them got diseases. Some of them don't know who they are. Now, somehow, some professors confused them, and they don't know if they're a boy or a girl. But bless God, we're all dressed up on Sunday. We're going to have church. Now, Antonio, would you send the prisoners? I know, I'm doing it. You just keep moving with me. Watch this. You think I'm up here playing games to entertain you? That's the last thing I could even care about. You won't find people preaching what I'm preaching here today because people are afraid. In the name of Jesus, Lord, redeem. Send them back to the church. Let redemption come, God. Let them come back, God. Let them come back. Would you put your hands up? Would you put your hands up as you come back in? Would you put your hands as they come back in? Father, in the name of Jesus, I order those that are tore out of the church and tore out of our homes and tore out of the areas of our city. I order them to come back before it's too late. I order them to come back with their hands up and with their attitude right and their heart surrendered to God. I order them to get it right. I order them to come and see the glorious church that's going to be like the Father that welcomes them back. We're going to be like the prodigal son's father. We're going to say, come on, bring them in. Give God praise here today. Give God glory here today. Oh,
Taryn, get up on the panel. Father, may it be what we have seen in the natural. May it be revealed in the spiritual. May we be awakened in this hour, God. May we be awakened out of our sleep and out of our slumber. And may we never forget this picture. May we see this picture night and day. May the trivial, trifle, selfishness of our life be crucified. May we bury this old man. May we bury this crucified old man. May we bury him. And may we say, oh God, forgive me for playing church. Forgive me for just coming to get my little nuggets and my little 2 cents and my little blessings. But God, turn me into an intercessor. Turn me into a person that weeps and cries for the souls of a generation that are being stolen right out of the church. Right under the nose of godly men and women. Right under the nose of godly women and men. And the enemy has sowed complacency, apathy. And we have the greatest opportunity that has ever been given to the church. If we would just lay down these things that we think are important and dedicate ourselves afresh to the Lord Jesus Christ, to the Lordship of Christ, that we would begin to pray at night. We begin to pray in the prayer room. We begin to fast more often. We begin to say, God, awaken us. Then our gospel would be made real. Our gospel would be relative. Our gospel would not be nominal. Our gospel would not be some dead thing. But God, we live on the doorstep of a Reformation. 500 years ago, in the 1500s, a man, only a young man, had an encounter with God. And it so changed his life that he penned a message that began to set fire to all of Europe. Germany was swept into the kingdom of God. Today, they can't hardly find believers. Will America be the same? Will our churches be turned into malls and boutiques? Will our churches be empty sepulchers of places that God once habited? Every Sunday we have over 100 people missing church. They'll come the next Sunday. They'll come the third Sunday. They'll come the fourth. They'll come in between. Every Sunday. Why? Because the enemy has successfully seduced us and drawn us out of the plan. God had a plan so that my generation, us baby boomers, I don't want to die and not see the ones and the 12s, the number one and the number two, the 1 year old to 12s and the 12s to 25. I want to see them run back into the house of God. I want to see them run back to God. I know that God, listen to me. I lived with those guys that surfed those waves. I surfed in those settings. I understand that culture and that crazy extreme. I understand it. Can I tell you? When I walked into my church,
I was used to riding waves. My wife will tell you, there were times I was out as far as you could go. Got held out on a reef at night. She didn't know where I was. She thought I was dead. The wave had caught me and took me out. And you take off on those waves at 40 miles an hour, there's nothing but life or death. But I didn't care. I had nothing to live for but that moment. These kids have nothing but the extreme. And we can't present a weak, half-baked, unsanctified gospel. It's got to be that prayer is working in your life. It's got to be that miracles are in your life. It's got to be that we're alive in God. Because they can tell when it's fake and phony. When I was preaching, young lady with the braids, turn around to me. When I was preaching, you were shaking your head. Because it made, what, you go to college? So you know that what I'm telling you is the truth. How old are you? 19. I've never met you before. You've probably been here, but nice to meet you. What's your name?
Jamie.
Here's Jamie, typical college kid. And she's amening me when I'm talking. Because she's probably seen the lukewarm, the casual. And her generation, they're not going to come in, saints. They don't want half-baked. They don't want your leftovers. If I came to your house today, would you get me some leftover meal? I hope not. Well, today I wouldn't come because they're fasting, but it would taste like it was leftover, even if it was fresh. Saints, I apologize for being real, but I don't know any other gospel. I only am alive. I'm only alive for one reason. That I might be a part of something one more time where the glory of God would sweep over this nation. And if I'm extreme to you, I'm sorry. I live with my own self. I told these young kids the other day, I said, if you think it's heavy when I preach it, you ought to hear when God's telling me. When I get it the first time, it's even heavier than when you get it. Young people, turn, face me. I'm going to pray for you. I didn't mean to do this, but we'll do it. Put your hands out this way. Close your eyes. I don't want you distracted. That's why. It don't make you spiritual. It just makes you not distracted. Father, in Jesus' name, church, 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 here I am talking to you, and now you're mumbling. You ought to be travailing. You ought to be praying like something's about ready to break loose, something happening. Look how many young people are in the church, saints. Father, in the name of Jesus, awaken these young people. Refresh them. Oh God, encourage them. May they not give up on us. May they not give up on us. May they trust us with their lives. But may we awaken out of our slumber, our laziness, our carelessness. May we wake up and say, oh God, here am I. Use me. Here am I, Lord, send me! Awaken, 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 awaken. O thou that sleepeth in Zion, wake up. Wake up, mothers. Wake up, fathers. Wake up, mothers. Mothers, wake up and begin to travail for the children. Wake up, dad.
God, send revival to these young people. Give them a reformation, a change of mind, a change of heart. May they not wait on the adults any longer. May they run to the prayer rooms. May they run to the house of God. May they run to the Word of God. May they hold not back another day. May they hold not back another moment. Turn their hearts. And Lord, may they go into every area of your purpose, and may they be successful. May it be like they are like Daniel. May they be like Gideon. God, may they go in and be successful. Everything they put their hand to, may it be obvious that there's an anointing on them. May others see it, be attracted to them. God, may they be the magnetic attraction of God. May they testify that heaven today has been talking about them all day. May they not be discouraged. May they be encouraged. May they not feel like second-class citizens, but may they arise to be citizens of the kingdom of God. You are the church. You are the church. You are the church. You're the church. It's your responsibility. It's your mandate. It's your obligation. It's yours. I'm going to pray this prayer. Everybody on your feet, I'm going to pray this prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, right now, all over this room, God, I pray for an awakening to happen in the pews and seats in this room. And that God, if it be, like Israel never went in, but Joshua and Caleb, they went in. If it be that you raise up another generation, God, let it be this generation right here that's in front of me. Those with a religious spirit, you'll miss it. Those that are just playing church, you'll miss it. God, I pray that these seats be filled with these kids. Send them from every corner. Send them from every corner, God. Lord, I pray that we disrupt colleges and erupt in those schools and high schools and all those schools, middle school in between, God, that you would cause something to activate over these students, over these young men and women. You would stir them at the deepest recess of their hearts. God, they lay aside every stupidity of thing they might be trapped in, caught in, entertained by, and they would see themselves as the next generation to take the gospel. You're the next generation to take the gospel. May God visit you at night. May God visit you in the daytime. May God visit you when you're unexpected, riding in your cars, sitting at your places to eat. May God intervene and interrupt. May your bedroom turn into a sanctuary. May your bedroom turn into a sanctuary of God. May your bedroom turn into a sanctuary of God. May your dorm turn into a place of visitation. May your dorm turn into a place of visitation. May your classroom become your mission field. May your classroom become your mission field. I assign you to that classroom. I assign you to that job. May you be a light and a witness at that place of work. And then lastly, I say this to you standing here. Look this way, please. There's never been in my lifetime, I've never seen it like it is. And I heard six men talk yesterday. These were men, y'all know Mark Sharona, those kind of people. That's Joe Matera. He was here. And they were burdened that God would just somehow cause a breakthrough to happen. But here's the thing, saints. Generation number four and generation number three. That's me, and that's the next one down. You listen to me. We are off base, many of you. We're off base and off target. And we are missing the greatest opportunity of a lifetime. To give our lives, I am so glad that at 22 years old, I gave my life to Jesus at 22. That's the life, that's the age of some of you maybe, or close. At 22 years old, I gave my life to God, walked out of the drug world. I could have been an attorney. I had opportunity to be anything in construction I wanted to be. My dad was over the largest in the state of Virginia. I could have done anything. I could have been in any of those fields. But when I got saved, I'd already been in hell through my background. But when I got saved, here's what I did. I had a prayer one night and I said, God, I will give you more than I gave Satan when I served him. And I was a drug addict and I was crazy to do what I did, surfing and all those kinds of things. I was crazy. Those kids are so out there. But when I got saved, I said, God, could you use me? And I had no idea. Never been in church. Didn't have a Bible. Didn't know how to read nothing. But I said, God, here I am. I am so glad today that I didn't go become a lawyer, become a construction guy, or any of those things. I am so glad that I had somehow enough we're all to say, here's my life at 22. I have no regret. I've been around the world. I've been to the largest churches in the world. I've been to the greatest islands. I've flown all over, been in the homes of presidents. I've been around the world. Hollywood people have been friends. I've been with the athletes. They've been with me, friends of mine.
from professional sports down, I can tell you, I'd rather do what I've done for Jesus than anything out there. And you millennials, you're listening. But you, baby boomers, 4 and 3, what is your purpose? Why did God save you? Just to get a paycheck? How cheap is that? What would it take for you to say, God, here am I? We do a play here called Eternity. And how many young people come? We can't even do it. Because we can't get people who'll commit their time. We've done it for 15 years or more than that. We can't even do it because we can't get people that will dedicate themselves. It's sad. Father, in Jesus' name, you can go back to your seats, please, and do it respectfully, please, quietly. Father, in Jesus' name, don't bother her. Leave her alone. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray. Would you pray with me? Come on, will you pray with me? Now, if you're going to go to heaven, you got to like me, so that's all. Reach your hands out this way. I'm going to pray for you. Isn't that marvelous to see that today? We just saw a living witness of the glory of God. Can you imagine if twice those kids came in the next 3 or 4 months? Can you imagine if 3 times that came in because they went out and started bringing people in? My wife and I went to a church in Latin America, Argentina. And the church was 5,000 people. But here's the mystery. It was all kids. The whole service was run by kids. The worship service was run by kids. A little girl that could hardly reach my belly reached up and laid hands on me, and the power of God knocked me down. The whole church was nothing but young kids. The parents had gone, and they stayed in the back and sat around the edges, and the kids ran the whole service. A little 10-year-old boy preached like hell was trying to draw him in. And I sat in marvel and said, oh God, the revival that hit the Hebrides revival started with a man who went to a 10-year-old boy and said, son, they were in a barn, would you pray? A 10-year-old boy went to pray and stopped. He said, whoops. He said, before I can pray, he said, Duncan Campbell was the preacher in the Hebrides revival. He said, before I can pray, he says, here's what I must do. I must tell the devil he's illegal to be here. So the little 10-year-old boy put his hands up and said, Satan, you cannot be in this meeting any longer. The barn began to move somewhere between 4 and 5 feet back and forth like this. The barn shook for hour after hour till the glory of God filled that barn. When they opened the door, 125,000 people had been swept into the kingdom of God through the Hebrides. A 10-year-old boy's prayer. What God could do with a kid like this. What God could do with this generation. But look at me, mom and dad. This is why we're fasting for the church. You understand it now? This is why we did this fast for the church. Because we need an awakening. You need to get hungry for God. You need to come to the prayer room. You need to get a hold of God and decide, I'm going to give up what I think I'm going to do, and I'm going to dedicate some time to God. I'm going to see something happen that's bigger than me. How many of you agree that we need to see something change? How many agree with me that something needs to change? Put your hands up. Let me see them, and I'm going to pray for you. Father, in Jesus' name, I have done what you told me to do. I cannot do anything else. I release this people today, God, to the anointing. I release them right now.
to the anointing of giving, to the anointing of doing what they've been called to do. They've been called to do. God, I release them now. That God, we're going to invest in another generation. We're going to invest in the kingdom of God. We're going to stop tipping God, and we're going to really dedicate this thing over to God and see revival break out, not only in our own church, but in the churches of this area. I declare, I decree that every church that will listen to the voice of God will begin to hear God say, it's time for the millennials. It's time for the generational shift begin to happen. And God's going to send a move of the Spirit over our houses, over our houses. Kurabari shetai. I know God is speaking to some of you right now. It's time for everybody in this house to begin to give generously, to begin to give like we have something in mind and we have a purpose. We're not giving just to see a church get money. We're giving so we can invest in what it is we're called to do as a church. So I loose you today to be generous and to obey the voice of God. Whatever God's told you to do, you rise to your feet and begin to get ready. We're going to bring a great offering to the Lord today. I don't mean some little half-baked thing. I mean a generous offering. We're going to give God something that will blow his mind. He's there before the... Listen to me. Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father, and he sees us giving. If he watched the giving when he was on the earth, don't you know the Holy Ghost is watching what we do? So today I release you for an anointed offering today. I release you to give as God is telling you right now, generously. Not programmed, not predetermined, but out of the spirit of anointing that God has put in this house and the revelation that we've all gotten together that this thing needs to grow, this thing needs to expand. We need to reach the next generation with everything that's in us. Now, I challenge you right now. We're going to worship the Lord. You bring that gift to the Lord. You bring that offering today, and you need to hear me. It needs to be a celebration giving. How many of you got a word today when you saw these kids? How many of you saw it? How many of you saw the message? Come on, pay attention. How many of you saw the message today? I mean, how many of you just said, I couldn't get it any realer? That I want you to give with that same passion of commitment to this next generation. Come on, let's worship the Lord. You bring your best to the Lord now. Come on.
In the name of Jesus, there is power, power in his name. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power, power in his name.